because I can drop in from here, which is lovely. The bridge is quite fun because you can change the colour.
This house is not just a pretty face, it's smart too. A central computer controls all the main functions, lighting, heating and ventilation, at the touch of a button.
Quite like this one, because you can gaze over the top and have a look
and
at people arriving
coming
and
then
cover a party or just see what's happening in the rest of the space.
High up here on the bridge, I can really appreciate Rick's passion for innovation. The steel struts and the curved glass wall, like a giant windscreen, reflect the technical achievement of the structure.
It reminded me when I was little, I used to go to the Natural History Museum and see the skeletons of dinosaurs, and it's like their ribs.
Rick was definitely trying to use materials in terms of its curved shape, and I think he was very excited because for the first time you could make quite economically a curved structure because computers could pick that up and sort that out. Equally, you know, you can bend glass now, you have that technology. Mm. And I also quite like the way that they're revealed in the swimming pool, but not in that one. So they just show themselves, they just give that hint, so you do understand how the structure works.
Yeah, you get to see just a sort of glimpse of the skeleton of the house, as it were.
Exactly, your dinosaur, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Look, you get the breeze. It's actually like being outside. You get a breeze in the trees.
It's lovely. It's really.
So you can
really
actually,
lovely.
Not only can you swim in your sitting room,
yeah,
you can sunbathe.
The lack of an external aspect of the house did not faze Rick Paxton. He simply brought the garden inside. The huge sliding glass roof panel opens up to the sky. Naturally, Rick incorporated automatic sensors to close the roof should the English weather intervene.
Rick very much had this idea, I think, that just, you know, sod it. Let's just go for it. Let's have a garden in our sitting room. Let's have a swimming pool in our... I mean, I half expect to walk through the door over there and go skiing. You know?
Now there's...
The main living area and master bedroom are separated from the four bedrooms in the children's zone by two sealed glass doors next to the open staircase. It's not a house for toddlers, this one.
Hi.
Hi there. Hi, I'm Simon.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Sorry to interrupt you. How are
you? Katie, hi.
Hi.
18-year-old Katie is following in her father's footsteps by studying architecture.
Lucky
I'm
girl.
I'm going to go say goodbye, darling, because I'm going to go and see Freddie play rugby.
Okay.
Thank you so much. I'll see you later.
See you later.
Your dad loved his toys, didn't he?
Yes.
Yeah.
No, my friend once joked that I lived in an iPod, which Dad took as a huge compliment.
So this here is the mirror image
of
your
room.
Yeah,
this is Fred. This is
Fred. I love it. You can really, if you stand here, it's exactly the same space, but that's so clearly a boy and so clearly a girl, because yours is full of Barbies and pink things and he's got a boxing bag and loads of blue.
Yeah, we do tend to go for stereotypes a bit. Yeah.
What's your favourite part about the house?
Either the swimming pool, I love swimming, and we had one when I was very little, so sort of almost as soon as we could walk, as soon as we could float, we were put in the swimming pool, and it is lovely just being able to swim up and down in the living room, go swimming at 3 a.m.
The bedrooms are like studio apartments with mezzanine sleeping areas. Freddie's room is almost identical. The house is a very substantial space, but Rick was determined not to waste an inch. Every little nook and corner is used, from the library shelving along the corridor to the sink by the rear entrance used to wash off muddy boots.
This is the back door, which allows Fred and I to have a very separate entrance. So when we come in at 3 a.m, being out and things like that, we don't disturb our parents and have a kind of... It just gives us a bit more freedom, which is great.
I love this mirror here.
Yeah, it makes the corridor feel much longer.
It makes you feel like you can go in and round the corner.
Go forever.
But have you ever walked into it?
No.
Any of your friends?
My friends once, there was someone standing there and they thought they were twins.
That was 3 a.m, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
At the far end of this muse within a muse, Heidi currently uses the fourth bedroom as a studio.
I love this wonderful arc.
It's fantastic.
Here, isn't it?
Upstairs, it's kind of like being in a little cocoon or a treehouse or something. Yeah. It's fantastic. There's a sort of childlike kind of enjoyment of the.
It's quite sort of church-like as well, in a way.
Yeah, especially with the... Because these are natural light.
Yes.
So you get the natural light into the space. And I don't know, there's something about a curve, because it's sort of unexpected,
yeah,
that makes the room feel really special.
Yeah. It's a church meets igloo.
Yeah.
You really feel at this end of the house that you're in a totally different sphere, don't you?
Yeah, it's...
You sort of forget that there's a big, long swimming pool in the sitting room over there. It just feels like a very separate place.
Well, that was Dad's intention, that Fred and I very much had our own space, so that as we grew up, we could become more independent, obviously still within the family unit, but we have our own acoustically private, was what Dad used to call it.
From the outset, Rick Paxton wanted a house that would be comfortable and easy to live in. But he also wanted his home to combine technological wizardry with environmental sensitivity. He incorporated energy efficiency systems which leave the house almost carbon neutral.
Now, I don't think I'm ever going to be able to get the chance to say this sentence again. I'm going to have a swim in the sitting room.
The swimming pool, while being outrageously flash, also acts as a massive heat sink, balancing the temperature of the rooms, all controlled by the house's computer system.
So when you're out in the sitting room, you've been looking at this swimming pool in your sitting room, this enormous great big aquarium. It's rather odd, but when you're in here, you forget that there's a sitting room just outside the swimming pool. It's only when you stand up like this and you see the sofa and the table that you realise that you are actually swimming in the sitting room.
Deep beneath the floor, the first geothermal piles in the UK produce heat from the ground. A highly sophisticated air distribution system helps maintain the temperature throughout the building, monitored and controlled by the central computer. It's a house with a brain as well as a conscience. Designing a house for his own family gave Rick Paxton freedom to experiment. He pushed as far as he dared, while retaining a sense of fun. The computer-controlled lighting makes the living area feel like a nightclub. As day becomes night, Paxton House enters the party mode. 16-year-old Freddie obviously has a keen eye for what his dad did best.
My dad, he was a bit of a perfectionist, and sort of certain things, like most people would just buy a tap, go and buy a nice tap, you buy a pretty tap, but the taps, you know, he spent a month designing it so it would swivel and come up and down and change. I mean, and you could have bought the same tap and it'd probably been just as nice, but he's one of those people who just had to design it. Like, if we went on holiday, for instance, and we go to some nice house in France, he'd spend the first 2 days just completely moving around all the furniture till he'd find the best use of space, because there's no sort of project he's worked on or was done where he hasn't made the absolute best out of what was there. If that's something, like, the space that was there, he's utilised the absolute max.
Well, this is a classic case.
Do you know what I mean? Completely landlocked site, no light. I mean, this is his little idea, so you can see what you've got. So, like, you can think, you know, think what you've got.
You've got to keep it tidy, though, haven't you?
You've got to keep, but it doesn't really matter, because it's just so you can see where stuff is. Because, yeah, you know, you're always looking at your, like, where's the bottle opener? See the bottle opener? It's there, do you know what I mean? You get
that's
it.
True.
So, and this is my favourite thing in the house, OK? It's called the magic drawer. Some may say it's an empty drawer, but what you do is when you have dirty plates, you put them in here, and magically you close it, and they come out clean.
That's genius,
I don't know how it is. Yeah. I think there's something to do with a cleaning lady and the washing machine being there. But
it's something to do with your mother, the other side.
In between there, it's something amazing happens, because all the drawers go through both sides.
Friends, client and family are coming for supper. Everyone is hugely impressed by Rick's work. Heidi's friend Judy loves the house and remembers Rick for his experimental approach.
He was like a kind of Victorian engineer, really. He was just that passion about everything that he did, about light, about hinges, about anything.